Thank you for watching Friendship Community Church Sermons on Demand. We're pleased you have decided to view our pulpit messages. Our Sermons on Demand are a ministry of Friendship Community Church and are provided as a resource to anyone who desires to study the Word of God. So open your Bible and get ready to dig into the Word of God and see what God has for you today.
Let's look at that. This is Matthew 2, verses 1 through 12, and it talks about the visit of the wise men. It says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.' When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for it is written by the prophet, "And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel."' Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you've found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him.' After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way." That's just about everything we know about the Magi biblically. We as a society, I guess, we as people have a lot of misconceptions and a lot of assumptions we've made about who they really were. But what were Magi? You know, let's just start with what were Magi and wise men. In ancient days, the Magi usually referred to a priestly caste from Zoroastrianism. Okay, they were smart guys, very well read. They were very knowledgeable in astrology, and at that time, astrology was considered a real science, and these guys were up on that. They were said to have the ability to interpret dreams. What a coincidence about them being able to interpret dreams when you read verse 12 here. But they were said to be able to interpret dreams. Again, they were very learned, very knowledgeable, very important people, primarily out of the Parthian Empire, and they even, according to some folks, they even had the ability to elect kings. They weren't necessarily kings themselves, but they had the power to elect kings in the Parthian Empire. Let's look at, speaking of the part, I didn't know, does anybody know where the Parthian Empire is besides you, Dan? Okay, I wasn't sure where it was. So here's the Parthian Empire. Okay, quite a big chunk of land. There we go. Here's Jerusalem over here. Boy, it's hard to hold this thing really steady. But here's Jerusalem over here, so Bethlehem is right around there. Persia. Down here, a lot of folks believe they came from Persia. So I'm using this side, Chuck, because that's where all the people are, you understand. So here's Persia. This whole thing was a Parthian Empire. So it was quite a big chunk of land. Once again, that's some of the area, Babylonia over here, Babylon, and a big chunk. Now, probably because of their position within the society, these guys were, again, they were probably very wealthy, and they had the freedom to travel pretty much wherever and whenever they wanted to. Some of the misconceptions, let's talk about some of the erroneous assumptions and misconceptions. We talk about, there were three when you read stuff. I think we've all heard the song, we three kings, we three this, we three that. Most of those assumptions come from the fact that the Bible mentions three gifts. And so they figure, okay, one person brought all, each brought a gift to make three wise men. Well, scholars are not settled on that. Certainly the Bible's not settled on that. We do know there was at least two. There's another question that was on there. We know there was at least two because it says they came. The pronoun they is used, so it's not just one. But we don't know how many. For instance, way back, here's a relief from some second century artwork, which shows how many. Probably two. We've got one here, we've got one here, we've got Mary. I would assume that's Joseph standing behind his wife, as he should. Huh? It's Leonard Nimoy. It does look a lot like Leonard Nimoy, but probably standing behind Mary, and he knows his place. And we also see that the child is not a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes at that point. This is a toddler-sized baby. But this is from the second century, and there's only two magi. So some folks assume there were only two. Some medieval artists depict as many as 12. It's just not anything that we know. Also, there are, let me show you another one. This is interesting. There are a lot of artists and commentators who not only depict three, one, two, three, but they depict them at different ages for different, representing different stages of life. Okay, we got the old guy with the gray beard here. We got the middle-aged guy, we're going to call him, with dark hair here. He hasn't turned gray yet. And we've got the younger guy here, once again representing that this Christ child was for everybody. He was for the old, he was for the young, he was for everybody. There's also a lot of artwork, as I mentioned, this guy that shows one of them as a dark-skinned man. Okay. Again, we don't know these things from the Bible passage, but they're often shown as a dark-skinned man. Now, personally, I tell you, let me go back to that. Personally, I think there was more than three. I don't think just three people took the trip. But I've got another slide. We'll talk about that a little bit. Okay, another assumption that was made is that they were kings. Once again, nothing in the Bible tells us that they were kings. We know they were wise men, but not kings. In art, they're often shown wearing crowns. Okay, once again, from the assumption that they were kings. It's obviously true that from the nature of their gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh, which were all very precious, they were wealthy. They had money or they wouldn't be able to provide those things. But once more, personally, I think that they were more kingmakers in the Parthian Empire as opposed to being kings themselves. Now we've, over the years, given them names. Caspar. Yeah, Bob. Caspar. The names really, they were popularized with the movie or the play Amahl and the Night Visitors. Okay, does everybody either know that or have heard of that before? Those names were popularized from that. However, they actually came from a Greek manuscript that was written around 500. So those three names are way back. Don't know where it came. Once again, the Bible is not specific on that, but we've kind of said, okay, they're Melchior, Caspar, and Balthazar. Not necessarily right. They have been in the Western Church. They're often regarded as saints. And they are, Melchior has been in the Western Church known to be a Persian scholar. We looked at where Persia was. Caspar was supposed to be an Indian scholar. We talked about Thomas going as far as India. And Balthazar was an Arabian scholar. So once more, these are all just kind of assumptions that have been made. Now, Eastern churches have different names for them rather than Melchior, Caspar, and Balthazar. And I read a thing that there are some Chinese Christians who actually believe that one of them, at least one of them, was Chinese. Didn't see any artwork with a guy that was like this, but some Chinese Christians think they were actually Chinese. But the bottom line is, we don't know who they were. We're once more not given their names. One of the other things you see with the wise men often is that they rode camels. We all, you know, when we see things, we see the camel sitting around. Did they ride camels? Don't know. However, in a real world, I think we can probably assume that they did. You know, camels were the transportation of choice for long journeys in those days. So in all probability, they rode camels. Now, I think, this is what I kind of mentioned before, I think this is more likely, this is BS is what this is. That's Butch speculation. Okay. I think it's more than likely that this is what it looked like when they came rather than just three guys. I mean, here's what's portrayed as the three wise men, but look behind them. If you remember what I said earlier, Magi were very important, very wealthy people. I can't picture three guys who might have been from slightly different areas going, let's just jump on our camels and ride. Okay? These guys were wealthy. They were used to being waited on. They were used to having all of their needs attended to. They're going to embark on a journey of unknown length to an unknown destination. If I was wealthy in those days, I'd call my people and go, okay, let's get the caravan ready. We're going. Okay? So this is more what I think happened with the three wealthy guys leading the pack. Once again, that's just BS. But I think they would go well prepared for a long unknown journey. Now we also hear that the star was in the east. Just like the We Three Kings song, there was a song we probably all heard called Star of the East. Actually, I think the star was in the west. They were in the east when they saw the star. Think back to the map on where they were, okay, where Jerusalem and Bethlehem was, all right? If they see a star in the east from them and followed it, they're going the wrong direction, okay? Now, it was in the east in relation to Bethlehem, but it wasn't in the east when it talks about them seeing a star in the east. It's really a star from the east. There are a lot of theories about exactly what the star was. Dan talked about some of them in his sermon a couple of weeks ago. Almost all those theories that Dan put forth are just way above my pay grade. So I'm not there. I found some things online that had all these constellation things. I was going to make a slide of those, and I went, why? 'Cause because I don't understand it. And quite frankly, although I love everybody here, I'm not sure any of the rest of us would understand it. It's just a bunch of stars and constellations with a line drawn in this. Yes, ma'am. Okay, Ann, you would understand it. No, I know you would. Was it? Well, I'm a simpleton, I guess. I think, once again, this is BS. I think it maybe was not even really a star, but more of a miraculous thing like the Shekinah glory. Okay? I think this star-like light appeared, and it appeared and led them. Part of my problem with it being a star, per se, is, or some configuration of constellations in the sky, is they'd only be able to travel at night, on non-cloudy nights, you know. And I'm not sure traveling at night through this kind of territory is a real good idea. Also, what happened to the Israelites when God was leading them in the desert? Did they not follow a star? Did they not follow a light? And what was that?
They followed the
pillar
of fire and
the
pillar of cloud.
The pillar of fire was an evidence of the Shekinah glory.
In all likelihood.
Exactly. Well, I think this is similar. I think this is an example of the Shekinah glory leading them. I do? Oh, that's good. Oh, they agree with me. Well, I'm good. I'm good here. But, you know, the interesting thing, and this made me think a little bit, and Rich and I batted this around some. The star did not take them directly to Jesus. Think about that just a minute. I mean, first we got the star appearing, and they're going, hey, we're going to take off for this trip, get the troops together, we're out of here. It took them where first?
Well, first it took them to Judea, it
took them to Jerusalem, right, in Judea. It took them to Jerusalem, huh? Well, they went to where Herod was first, okay? And so it took them to Jerusalem, where Herod probably was. Why didn't the star take them directly to the Christ child? Exactly. But isn't that, you know, why did that happen? It took them to Judea. They asked around. And it's pretty evident they're going, where is this? Where is this child-born king of the Jews? Well, you know, we're looking for him. Where is he? So they were asking around. Herod obviously heard all this going on, got together, as the scripture says, what's going on here? The scribes and advisors and stuff told him, so he summoned the Magi to him to ask them. And so he asked them, which led to the slaughter of the innocents. All right, now after they had seen Herod, then the star took them to the house in Bethlehem. I don't think the star settled over that house in Bethlehem to start with, or they would have gone straight to the house. Why would they have wandered around in Jerusalem asking, where is he, and ended up with the situation where they're talking to Herod? Well, yeah, that could be, but I think the star took them to Jerusalem first. Right, and then they saw it after they left Herod. then it went to, because I guess it probably depends on which version we're going to use. Right. Because here 9 says, after listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. So, I say, had it been over the house in Bethlehem to start with, they could have just bypassed Herod. Does that sound reasonable? Also interesting, you know, well, I don't want to, philosophically, isn't it something we can't understand what God's doing? Why did God lead them to Herod, which resulted in the slaughter of the innocents? Why did he not take them directly to Bethlehem? Now, I know you're going to probably talk about some of that stuff on Christmas Eve. Is that not right? Fulfilling some prophecies? All right, Rich and I talked about this, and Rich said that there were some prophecies in the Old Testament that hinted at children dying.
Oh, yeah, a voice of Rama crying out, mothers, where are your children?
Yeah. So.
There are at least 48 specific prophecies about the birth of Christ in the Old Testament. I'm just going to take 20 at kind of random.
Okay. But not that one. Okay. But it's still, even if it was fulfilling that prophecy, you know, don't you, you know, we ask, why do good people die? Why does God take this person? Why do we have world wars? Why? You know, the real question is, why do we question a sovereign God? But, you know, that was a thought that went through my mind. Why did God not put the star right over the little house in Bethlehem and not sacrifice, not have it result in the slaughter of the innocents? Anyway, that's the kind of stuff that it'll take runs through your mind when you're doing all this. Your mind kind of goes crazy when you're researching all of that. But at any rate, let's get back to where we were. I think that's where we were, I believe. Now, some other misconceptions is we see when we look at nativity scenes, very often we see the three wise men or three kings there. Absolutely not correct. Okay, the Bible says that the shepherds were the only ones that visited the Christ child in swaddling clothes in the manger. The wise men visited him at a later time, but this is a typical nativity scene. You know, pretty much, there's a guy. These are portrayed, I think, as the three wise men. You'll notice that probably this one and this one, their headwear could be construed as crowns. I'm not sure what kind of headwear that is, but at any rate, here's their,
Klingon,
yeah. Yeah, he does, doesn't he? He could be from where? What?
Beldar from.
Anyway, the Coneheads. And here's the camels are portrayed there. Not in the Bible. All right. Obviously, Mary, the baby Jesus, sheep. We're not told sheep were there, but we assume sheep were there because this guy was probably the shepherd. Okay, because he's taking good care of the sheep. There's the cow. Nope, not mentioned. Probably Joseph. My guess, although she's holding a sheep, is she another shepherd or could that be Elizabeth? I don't know. Oh, sorry. I'm just thinking, maybe whoever did this, since they got part of it wrong, maybe they threw Elizabeth in there as well. All right, Gabriel with the trumpet?
The only angel I know with a trumpet is Moroni, and that's Book of Mormon stuff, so I'm going
to
leave it alone.
Okay, well, we're not talking about correctness here. We're talking about what we usually see. I don't think it looks like Harold. Yeah, more like a Frank instead of a Harold.
Harold Angel.
Right, Hark the Herald Angels.
They're
Right. This little one, what do we think this little angel is?
One of the cherubim.
One of the cherubim. So I like it. And the only one left is, my theory is that's a little drummer boy. Huh? I don't know where his drum is, but I'm going that's the little drummer boy. But at any rate, we often see this kind of thing in nativities. It is.
Yeah.
And that's absolutely not biblically correct. But that's what we've seen. Now, especially because we are told this isn't right with the kings, okay? And the reason we know that's not right is we know in the Bible what the order of events were. Okay, the first thing that happened, Jesus was born. Next, the angels appeared to the shepherds. Okay, the shepherds, and they were told to go seek him. By what means? How would they recognize him? What were they to look for?
Boy, swaddling clothes.
Shepherds visit. Their sign was the baby in a manger. Again, once again on Linda's quiz. This one was on the quiz. Okay, they did not follow a star. That was not a key for them. Right? Per custom, 8 days later, Jesus is circumcised. 6 weeks later, after Mary has been through her purification process, they take him to the temple to have him consecrated. Joseph, Mary, and Jesus go back to Bethlehem and live in a house. Now, there are some commentators who say that they left after the consecration and went back to Nazareth. And then back, and I don't know why they do all that traveling. No, you couldn't exactly jump on an express. Because of the next event we've got, I believe they went back to Bethlehem and they got out of the stalls and they moved into a house. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to say time-wise is the Matthew account. Matthew consistently uses the term paidon, which means toddler. Luke, in the manger scene, talks about grephos, which means newborn or suckling. And so Luke uses a pediatric term to talk about a newborn baby. By the time the Magi arrived, he was walking. As to why they were still in Bethlehem at that point,
yes.
Since they don't baptize as small babies, just exactly what was the consecration?
You want to speak to that, Dan? Because I'm not familiar with Jewish ritual.
Mostly it had to do with the giving of an offering and the presentation of the child. It's a little bit like christening nowadays. As a matter of fact, if you will talk to the pastors of churches that still do beta baptism, baptizing babies, and the christening business, what they will tell you is that that's the New Testament analogy to what happened in the Old Testament. What they're thinking is, if God set up these important rituals, who are we to come along and then just cut them off and say, we're not going to do that anymore? What they say is, unless you and I have specific instructions that something is supposed to stop, we need to keep doing it. And that's why they have the christening ritual, because it's basically their way of following through on this business of the consecration in the temple.
Reader's Digest version.
What they did was they presented the child, basically said, God, this child is yours. We're going to take care of it. And they presented the appropriate sacrifice.
Perfect.
Which was a pair of turtle doves.
Perfect. Well, they didn't have a lot of money at that point. That's right. All they had was a pair of turtle doves. Okay, so after they go back and they live in a house, now the wise guys show up. Okay, we know that because the Bible tells us that they entered the house. All right, didn't say they went back into the stable. They entered the house. So that's pretty much the order of events. So we know that that nativity scene is not correct. Probably, depending upon who or what you read, the theories, as Dan said, probably a toddler. Most folks believe that they arrived when the baby was somewhere between 6 months and 2 years old. The 2 years is based primarily on the fact that Herod ordered all the children two and under to be killed. Probably, I read another commentator who said, probably not quite two yet, because he thinks that Herod gave himself a little window. We're not told, if you look at the account, we're not told when the star appeared. We are not told that. Obviously, the wise men knew that. But we're not told when the star appeared.
One of the most important things he was quizzing them about
was when
the star appeared, which tells me that it was the kind of astronomical phenomenon that unless you knew what you were looking at, you couldn't interpret it. These people lived on their roofs 5-6 months out of the year because it was too hot to sleep inside the house. They didn't have light pollution. They didn't have a Walmart parking lot with all these sodium vapor lights. So they were accustomed to lying on their roof at night, seeing the stars without much in the way, because in the high desert it's easy to do. And so they would be intimately familiar with what the night sky looked like. If there's any kind of astronomical anomaly or disturbance, they would have noticed it pretty quickly. Whatever it was, Herod didn't know, his astrologers didn't know. They had to ask the Magi, when did this star appear? What did it look like? Where was it? What's going on?
Okay, Dan. Oh, Dan. Dan, calm down, Dan. Dan.
Was it a comet?
Okay. No, I don't believe it was a comet either. I could have been a UFO. There, that's right. Could have been his mothership. Absolutely. Okay. But anyway, as commentator, I say, or some commentators don't think it was quite two because, as I said, number one, we don't know when the star appeared to the wise men. Did it appear on the day Christ was born? Did it appear at some point later? We don't know that. We don't know that. Probably when he was born, but once again, we're not told that specifically. Now, if you try to put yourself in Herod's mind, once all this stuff happened that Dan's saying, he gets all these guys together, what's going on? They tell him, this prophecy is coming true. He sneakily gets the wise guys in and he says, go find the child. Let me know, when did this happen, et cetera, et cetera. I want to go worship him. The wise men go off. They go see the baby. Gee, they interpreted dreams, didn't they? They had a dream and went, we're not going back to Herod. So they took off. Now one commentator said, you know what? That probably aggravated Herod. Herod was the ruler, and he ordered these guys, come back to me. They didn't come back. And so this commentator says, Herod probably then didn't trust the wise men. Okay, if he couldn't trust them to come back, how could he trust what they said? He didn't trust. That was a TV show, Dan. But that's dating both of us. Who do you trust? So this guy said maybe the baby again could be a toddler, was only about a year or so, and Herod went, well, if I can't trust them to come back, I can't trust that they told me the truth when they saw all this. So instead of just killing year-old kids, I'm gonna have a nice cushion. Because I don't believe him and don't trust him. So let's make it from 2 years down. Makes a lot of sense when you think about the type of guy Herod was and what was going on then. Okay, so let's talk about, as we search for Jesus as they did, what can we learn from the Magi? All right, the Magi had an attitude. They actually had three attitudes, okay? And those three attitudes are really the lesson of the Magi. The Magi had an attitude or a sense of urgency. Right? Once again, three wealthy, learned guys in a high position. They were familiar with some biblical prophecy because Thomas, they maybe had been taught by Thomas. They were very intelligent guys. There were a lot of Jews living in the Parthian Empire. We remember the Jews, a bunch of them went to Babylon, right, for the captivity. After 70 years, a bunch of them went back, but a lot of them didn't go back. So there was not just a pocket, there was a substantial Jewish population who would have shared their faith or shared their books or whatever. These magi were some of the smartest, most learned people. So they obviously were familiar with that. When they saw what was going on, they maybe said, this is fulfillment of that prophecy. We're going to go. So they had a sense of urgency to get there. They had one thing in mind, and that was they wanted to find this king. They had an attitude of joy. All right, the scripture tells us the scripture tells in 9 and 10, we just read that, and as Ann said, that when they got there, they were joyous. They had found what they were looking for. We might look at that as a sense of anticipation and joy. What occurred to me is of course, we've all done a lot of traveling, but I was thinking about some trips Michelle and I have been on, and you know, we'll go through some airports, and you know what it's like when you come off a plane and you're walking through the airport, and up just outside the security area, you see people waiting for their loved ones to come off the plane. You see this sense of anticipation in their eyes, waiting. And then sometimes, if you're really lucky, you'll see the loved one appear, and you see this absolute look of joy on the person that's waiting. They've been anticipating that, and they're just so joyous and so happy when they see the loved one. I think that's the way the Magi were. They had this sense of anticipation, and when they found the Christ child, they were just overjoyed. Most importantly, I think they had an attitude of worship. Okay? They told Herod they had come to worship him. And the scripture says, when they found the child, they bowed down and worshiped him. That's the whole purpose of their journey. Okay? It wasn't all about the journey. It's what made the journey worthwhile. Now, part of their worship was a giving of gifts. Just like part of our worship is a giving of gifts here. Okay, part of their worship was a giving of gifts. Dan did a masterful job a couple of weeks ago with the gold, frankincense, and myrrh and tying them all together in that one theory. I don't know about you guys, but I love that. Just between you and me, that's the best sermon I've ever heard Dan give. I'm not going to say it, but that's the one I love the most out of all the times Dan has talked. Okay, never mind. So, but besides that, there are some other theories on tying together the gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold, for instance, was a gift given to a king and fit for a king. Speaking of gold, I got a little story. There was an old guy named John, you call him whatever you want, who was getting very old, had amassed enormous wealth. But he was a really good Christian man and gave gifts to the church, supported missions, and the more he gave, the more he was blessed. And he just amassed an enormous amount of wealth, but he was getting kind of old. One night God comes to him and says, John, your days have come. My man, I'm going to take you home tonight. And John says, it's okay with me, Lord. You know, I've had a great, wonderful life, and you've blessed me. He says, but I want to ask you a favor. He says, I've tried to be such a good member of your flock. I've tried to follow you. but I've worked so hard to amass all of this wealth. Can I bring some of my most precious stuff with me? God says, well, we don't really do that. He says, well, Lord, I've given away so much of my stuff. I've been a good guy. I've been your child. God said, okay, one suitcase. I'll make an exception in your case. So before he passes, John goes to his vault, and he goes in. He's got a bunch of gold bar bullion in his vault. So he takes one suitcase and loads some bullion up in the suitcase. And he goes back and gets by his bed. And during the night, God took him. So he shows up. All of a sudden, he shows up to St. Peter at the gate. And St. Peter says, okay, name, please. John gives him. Okay, John, you've been a great guy. Come on in. John starts to pick up the bag. St. Peter says, whoa. You can't bring anything in with you. And John says, but I talked directly with God, and he made an exception. He said I could bring in something that was really precious to me because I'd been so good. And St. Peter says, well, okay, I'm going to have to check. So St. Peter's gone. He comes back. He says, you know, you're right. I've never seen this happen, but God said he made that deal with you. Okay, you can come in and bring the bag. He says, but I'm dying of curiosity. You know, what is it that you would bring to heaven with you? You know, can I look? John says, sure. He opens the bag, and here's all this bullion, and St. Peter looks at it and goes, you brought pavement? <Ba-dum-bum>. Okay. Sorry, but the punchline was a surprise to me. Anyway, okay. So they brought gold, which is a gift fitting for a king. They brought frankincense. Once again, Dan has talked about that. It was very costly perfume, often used by the priests in their censers in the temple. They brought myrrh. Once more, Dan told us and showed us all of that. One of the primary uses of myrrh was as an embalming substance. Some say that foreshadowed Jesus' death, therefore Jesus saving us from our sins by his death. Okay, so if you look at those gifts, then besides that marvelous thing Dan put together for us, they brought gifts for their God or their king, their high priest, and their savior. Okay, probably caught Mary a little bit off guard. It's a, you know, you got to admit that was probably a pretty unexpected baby shower with those kind of gifts. But that's also probably what gave them the money to escape to Egypt, you know, and to help raise our Savior. For the wise men, the journey wasn't the objective. For the wise men, worshiping the Christ child was the objective. As we seek Jesus in our lives, we need to have an attitude or sense of urgency. I think Les has got the bumper sticker he had for us, that those that want to wait to know God on the 11th hour often die at 10:30, something like that. We need a sense of urgency. We need to seek him now, forever. We need to have an attitude of joy when we find him. If putting Jesus Christ in your life doesn't make you happy, you're in trouble. You're in more trouble than you know. And we need to have an attitude of worship. Those are the attitudes. That, in my opinion, is a lesson that the Magi teach us. And that's what we hopefully we'll take away from this, and we'll be able to worship the Christ child as our Savior. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do ask that you can help us develop those attitudes in our life. We know we need to seek you, and we try to do that. We know when we find you, it should bring absolute joy to us. And we really want to worship you. You're just so deserving of that, and we're not deserving of the mercies and the salvation that you've given us. We ask that you be with us during the rest of the service today. Be with Rich as he comes to give us the message. Give him physical strength for this period of time as he leads us in your word and in the things that you've directed him to tell us today. We thank you for the gift of your precious son. You know, we're not sure what the birth date is, but we celebrate it in this week coming up. Let us remember why that day is so special for us, and remember that you sent us our Savior who came to be able to provide us with everlasting life. Be with the congregation as we listen today. Be with everybody during the week. Please give everybody a safe and blessed Christmas coming up. We ask these things in the name of your precious Son.
Thank you for watching this sermon on demand at Friendship Community Church. If this message has been helpful to you in your understanding of the Word of God, please let folks at Friendship Community Church know by sending an email to watching@friendshipcomchurch.org. Thank you again for watching, and we look forward to seeing you in person at Friendship Community Church.